about the Two of America's Most Wanted video, there's a little bit footage of the street version of the shoot. Was it supposed to be another take of the video, or do you have information about it?
You know, what's funny about that video is I was producing it, and a couple days before the shoot, the guy that was supposed to direct it called my partner Tracy and said, I don't want to direct it. And we were like, what are you talking about? This is Tupac and Snoop. And he said, I don't want to share credit with Tupac, because Tupac had written the script. It was his idea. And this cat was like, I don't want to share directing credit with Tupac. So Tracy knew that I wanted to direct. And she just went up to Tupac and said, you know, Gobi wants to direct. And Pac said, let the motherfucker do it. So that was the first directing gig was Two of America's Most Wanted. So
okay.
The video was supposed to be a 3-day shoot. And we shot 2 days worth of footage. And on the third day, Pac turned around and he said, you know, Gobi, you guys have got enough footage for a video. Me and Snoop are out. So they both jumped in his roles and just took off. And that was it. We had to shut the video down. So some of the footage of them performing in the streets was by the L.A. River downtown. And, you know, that was just a portion. He was right. We had enough for a full video. So, you know, we didn't even use some of that stuff. There was only a little bit of that at the end when they're walking, but there's no performance. And what's funny is at the end, the way we shot it, when they walk out of the limo, there's a whole bunch of dead cops around them. But we had to edit the cops out, obviously, because no one would accept that.
Yeah, exactly. And how was the atmosphere during this video shoot with Snoop and Tupac?
Well, I mean, you know, it was the first time I had, you know, directed a music video. And, you know, I had obviously a lot of experience producing and directing from behind the scenes when I was doing videos for like Ice Cube or Mac 10, where they would get the directing credit, but I would kind of have to do all the hard work, like the editing and the color correction and whatnot. So on Two of America's Most Wanted, there's a scene where the two of them are sitting in a private booth, and the camera's going in and out. And when I shot that and the scene was finished, I just walked up to the two of them. I mean, you know, they were blazing weed, and so they were high and whatnot. But I walked up to them and I said, you know what? You two, I can understand why you're making so much money, because you motherfuckers rock. And they just both giggled, you know. They just both had a good laugh at that, because, you know, I mean, so it was just, for them it was unexpected, but I was so loving the footage, and I knew that video was going to be a hit. It was so clear to me, you know?
Yeah.
So, so that's it.
And do you know what happened between Tupac and Snoop Dogg in the last days of Tupac's life?
No, I really don't know the details of what happened or why they fell out. I don't have any of that information.
Okay. Yeah, you did the Hit 'Em Up video as well. Are there a lot of scenes that were not used in the final music video?
There were a lot of, yeah, I mean, there was a lot of footage that was shot. And there were a lot of effects that were done. Like when Pac morphs into Yafeo Yaki, or vice versa, you know, I did those effects with a special effects guy. So, you know, there were a lot of those effects that just weren't used. But, you know, I think a little bit of all the scenes were used. Not all, but a little bit of all of them were used.
Okay. And what were your personal thoughts about this song and about the video?
It's funny. I didn't really think about the content of what we were doing with Pac when we were doing with Pac, because it's almost like I feel like I signed up to do whatever he wanted to do, and I didn't really question, you know?
Yeah.
to me, I was just the director, producer that was putting the project together, and that was that. I didn't question his decisions when it came to videos or projects that he wanted to do.
You did All About You as well, right?
Yeah.
Why Gaddafi, Nadog, and Snoop were not used in the music video?
You know, it's funny. That's a good question. I have no idea, because that was one of the first videos we produced for Pac, and I'm really not sure why they weren't.
Okay. No. And there's a solo version of the video as well, with Pac doing a third verse, but which was not released official. And why this was not released?
I don't know. I think that's because Shook, I've actually got the video on my site. That one with Tupac doing the verse, I believe, is on my website, so you can check it out. I think what happened was Pac passed, and then before the video was released, Shook, I think he put one of his own artists on the third verse.
Yeah, you did a video of Life Goes On as well. It was not official. What's the story about the video?
That was just a video that was made for a Tupac memorial that was in Atlanta. And what bummed me out about that video is I kind of did the video, and I did it for free for the mom, which, you know, obviously that doesn't mean anything. But then Interscope kind of copied the video. And then when they made the changes video, it's almost like they cherry-picked a lot of the shots and used the same thing. So that kind of bummed me out. Yeah, it was a video I did for the memorial. I think it was a year after Pac's passing.
Okay, nice. Do you have a funny or interesting story about you and Tupac that you would like to share with us?
Well, I mean, you know, there was... There was a comedian by the name of Paul Mooney that we had given some money to. Tracy and I had given some money to write a script with Tupac. And I remember I walked into the trailer, and him and Pac were talking, and Paul Mooney's like, "So Gobi, where are you from? You know, why dude, where are you from?" I said, "I'm Iranian." And then he looked at Pac and he said, "Oh man, you gotta watch out for these motherfuckers. These motherfuckers are terrorists. He'll strap some C4 on you and blow your ass up." And, you know, even though he was joking, it was funny because I was looking at Pac when he was talking, and Pac just had a smile on his face while he was looking at me. And, you know, it was just cool to be thought of in that way. I mean, look, I grew up, you know, I had my fair share of fights and whatnot, but I didn't grow up in the hood, and I definitely did not grow up with gun violence. So I'm far from a gangster, but I felt like a soldier around him. And I think that's something that everyone that was around Tupac felt like. We all felt like we were his soldiers. And to me, I almost felt like I wanted to be more like an older brother, and wished and hoped one day I could have the type of relationship where I could give him some advice about my views on what I saw, like him being on death row or the people that are around, or, you know, the elements. He was not what he surrounded himself with.
Okay. And, a lot of people are saying that he was not really happy at death row and he wants to leave death row. What's your view on that?
He was ready to leave death row. Euthanasia, and he was definitely ready to leave death row.
And euthanasia, would that be working with death row as well, or would it really a separate record label?
No, that was going to be his own record label.
Sad it never happened.
Yeah.
And what is the most important thing that you learned from Tupac?
Never to give up and always to go for it. And I think, really, even though I learned the lessons, it's taken all these years, 16 years, for them to kind of settle in.
And there's a rumor that Tupac was not really happy that he and needed to go to Vegas.
No, he didn't want to go to Vegas. I think Sugar tried to get him to go to Vegas a few times before that, and he just didn't want to go to Vegas.
And was there a reason for that?
I have no idea, but I think he went because of the Tyson fight, because he had a very good relationship with Mike Tyson.
Yeah, he recorded 3 or 4 songs for Mike Tyson.
Yeah.
And do you have any last words for the fans?
No, I really want to give the fans an experience with this documentary that they've never had with Tupac before. And I guess, you know, I'm subjective because it's almost like 16 years I've waited to finally do this project, and now it's time.
All the fans are waiting years and years for something new, and everybody's waiting for something like this.
All right, cool.
And, it's really nice. And, thanks a lot for doing this interview. It was really a pleasure for me to talk to you.
Lars, I got to appreciate you and your forum, because if you're the representative of this forum, I have to tell you, Pac would be proud of you, because you're an honorable individual and you're not about sensationalism. You're about the truth.
Thanks a lot for these nice words, man. And I speak to you soon.
All right, bud.